reasons for it. And so, and Matt sees both sides of it. I think at the beginning level, we kind of start agreeing that the beginning level, it's probably not a good idea. We should start thinking about all this, the residual effects of that. But anyway, so he's going to talk about it. He also said his professor at Eastman. So we're honored to have an Eastman grad here talking to us. Was a huge buzzer, and then of course Brian and I had Larry Campbell, who's an Emory Remington disciple from Eastman, and we were, you know, into the buzzing thing, and at a higher level, it's probably, you know, a worthwhile thing. But, and he said there was a panel discussion with his professor and Alan Mizzuti, kind of.
They're both real nice, like non-confrontational guys, so it was interesting.
So he was, you know, kind of like two Henry Kissingers trying to get their point across. Yeah.
It's that way at Indiana State too. When Bill Adams was alive, he was a non-buzzer, but yeah, the other guy was.
And his disciples are, yeah.
Yeah, Carl Sievers and all those guys.
I can remember talking about Levi's buzzing too. I'm glad you brought up Bill Adams.
So. Yeah. So anyway, let me get out of his way. Matt.
All right. And this is a real opportunity for me because it's something I feel strongly about. The trumpet especially, the first few sessions, when you put it on a kid's face, determine an awful lot. If they're lucky and they get set up in a way that's workable, then they just feel talented. Even if their actual musical potential is mediocre, if they've got a great setup to start with, they're much less likely to quit in the first 2 years, you know? And it's all more frustrating when you got a kid with really solid ears and you've all had that trumpet player, or you've all had that brass player who athletically just couldn't get around the instrument. Like their relationship with the instrument was not good, but their ears are great, their rhythm's great. I mean, what you do is you make them a drum major or a French horn player, right? Or something. But the first few sessions of putting the trumpet on a kid's face, they're, I think, really critical. Because once they have that first memory of making a vibration, of making a sound, they'll tend to stick with whatever that was. And it's not a solvable problem, really. Part of the problem is that when you start a group of kids in a method, that method will generally start really low in the register. Like it'll start with, they'll ask for the low G, and then you learn everything below they'll ask for that second line G, and then you'll tend to learn the notes under that G, and they end up setting up for kind of a low, big, somewhat flabby aperture that locks them out of the high register. So this whole process we're going to get into is partially to get to set up that aperture so that it's the right size, so that it's friendly to a faster airstream. And it's also about starting with a less effortful sound production. And hopefully a healthier sound from the beginning. The buzzing thing at first, if the kid's first experience of making a vibration is in the buzz, they can tend to be pretty over-engaged. You know, they can tend to really be gripping the airstream. And so that's like a different set of problems. Let's see, do I want to say it? No, I'm not going to talk about that. Okay. Now, the first two categories here are probably pretty similar to what you do already. And the only point I want to make about the breathing is that to get the student really full, I'll start with a timed inhale that's at least four counts. You know what? You guys already do that stuff. They need a long inhale to get full. But the holding of the inhale is a problem, because they're trying to set up their face for the first time, and they'll go... And that delay ends up sort of thwarting the formation of the embouchure we're looking for, and the sound production we're looking for. So there's going to be a lot of references in here to trying to make the release immediate, even if what you get initially is even if it's harder initially to get that ignition. Part of that is that when they're holding, there's like an isometric locking of the inhale and exhale muscles, and then they don't let go of that as they're exhaling. They exhale with that isometric lock pretty over-engaged. That can be a problem. your thing, this is probably also the stuff that you already know, but keeping the bell high and the elbows out tends to, the usual sort of degenerate posture that kids are gonna wanna fall into pulls the horn into a downstream position that will really screw up the embouchure, and then they start to associate this with moving more air. And you deal with that with all the, with various instruments, but because of the way the horn is held, they're really vulnerable to this. So I wrote this guy in Houston Symphony who played really like this his whole career, and it looks silly, but I get it. Like, he's, at some point he must have had that problem, and he said, all right, damn it, I'm just gonna, you know, go the other way, all the other way. So if your kid looks, if your student trumpet players look awkward, if, you know, that's okay. It's better to err this direction than to let them start to get into this. And you're gonna see when we talk about putting the horn on the face that we're gonna do it from a, what starts with a rather upstream position, because the tendency to end up with that clarinet looking embouchure is so strong that you really have to counteract that. And it's great if they've seen, if they see some professional trumpet players in a solo role, they'll see that they're always standing with the bell even above a 90 degree angle. They're really projecting up and out, and that's a huge help if the concept is up and out instead of down and in. But because if they see even professional trumpet players in ensembles, we tend to keep our bells more down because if the conductor sees the bell, they're going to react, right? It immediately psychologically sounds louder. It probably is louder. Okay, hand position, the natural curve of the fingers. You want the kid's hand position to be basically the resting, the hand position they have in the state of sleep, whatever the resting hand position is. You just want to lay that on the horn. A lot of teachers make a big deal out of the not having the pinky ring, and that's worthwhile, but not actually as huge an issue as I think a lot of teachers make of it. The kid's eventually going to have to learn to deal with this, you know, turning pages. But most important is the hand is in a rest position and not here. And you'll see this once in a while, and that's not awesome either, the overcurl. And I start them, did I mention that? Yeah, I tend to ask my students early on to really slam the vowels. I want the vowel stroke to be super quick. No time down and up, just an on or off switch is what I tell them. And then if I have them fingering something without playing, I want it to sound like a drum, like a snare drum sort of accuracy, and also some volume, enough volume that you hear, you know, you can hear the evenness of any fingering if they're pounding it like that. Later on, if they want really fast tempi, they have to learn to dial that down and throw their fingers. But that's a long way off. I'd rather, we're compromising relaxed fingers that they would want at a really high level of playing for the clarity of slamming the vowels, for the clarity of what that does for the chops and the wind and the timing of everything. So start them out really pounding the vowels. And there are pros who still endorse that. I think when you're playing something light and quick, you don't have, that will bog you down. That's my like caveat about that. It just doesn't apply to your 10-year-old yet, you know. And then the ring for the right hand. Try to make sure that it's adjusted so it looks like that. So if you put a little eyeball here and here, you get the elephant, you know, and it looks kind of even. Their elephant will be smaller than mine, but it'll be, the ring will be, you know, closer to the valve casing. And then just really torque that screw, so, because you know it ends up coming loose, and then that's also their excuse for not, or they lose it, of course, but that's their excuse for not using it. And you can do rhythmic type exercises with them without fingers, like 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1, 2, 3, 4, and 1, 2, 3, and 1, 2, 3, and that kind of thing. So they feel that they can, it's sort of the opposite of what I was saying about the energetic right hand. This hand, you really want them from the start to feel they can just throw that, to feel how little energy it really takes to throw that thing out and back. Because your bands play so many things where you're at least, you're either in B flat or you're passing through B flat, so you're using about, I mean, if you're using that D, if it's the second note of the scale, written D, it, you know, you hear it, it sounds god awful, and it's never in tune. It's a lot of work to get that out of young players. So you really want to habituate, and I, telling them that this is personal, like how far you have to go is personal, yeah, it is, but I just tell them, for the low D, I want to see about a little over a centimeter, and for the low D flat, I want to see a full inch or more. But you can just tell them this is how far out it goes. Don't expect, they're not going to be refined enough to say, well, for me, that low D is not quite as far out, and they'll figure that out, but not, you want to make it simple for them. This is the position for D, this is the position for D flat, and it's wrong if it's not that. Because what you end up with is a mix of kids who are diligent enough to throw out the third slide, to adjust with the slides, and then the kids who are not. And the mix of those is even nastier than having, you know, nobody using the slide, which I think is often what happens. Okay. Okay, now we get to the stuff that is maybe more novel or hopefully will be useful to you. A lot of the stuff I got from, I love doing this presentation because a lot of this I got from my teacher in Houston, Armando Gatala, and he died in like 2001. So I just, I end up remembering his way of doing things. That's really great. He never published any of it, so it's, yeah, nice to proselytize his whole approach. Now, I start the kids without the trumpet in front of them. Or I started without holding the trumpet. I want them just to focus on, we'll do the breathing first, and then I want them to focus on position, putting them in a position where they're most likely to find this embouchure that I'm after. The first thing, and it sounds controversial because it may feel extreme to you, but I'm right about this, okay? I've done it a lot with students. Their teeth need to be aligned, and that may require what you would perceive as jutting of the jaw. I mean, the jaw needs to come forward enough that the teeth are even. And if you check your teeth with a finger, because you won't really believe that it needs to be that far forward, the natural, have you guys noticed that, like, kids with a natural underbite tend to be successful brass players? Have you seen that? I don't know. You will now if I mention that. The underbite gives them a flat surface. It's a big deal. The even teeth gives them the flat surface. The natural overbite we all have immediately puts the lower lip behind the upper lip and creates a downstream and a lower vibration. It's like a physiological problem. It's not good for a person to jut their jaw for hours a day practicing. Sorry, that's what the trumpet wants. It's, and your body gets used to it. You end up with enough muscle memory that I think, that, so at first the kid is gonna constantly revert back to their resting position. And you have to remind them, especially at first, so that they don't end up with that downstream situation. So you set the teeth evenly, you make the kid check that with their finger, because they won't really believe how far forward their jaw has to be. And then the lip roll, the muscle that rolls the upper lip in may not be one that they use a lot in the normal movement of their face when they're expressing themselves or whatever. That roll of the upper lip is a big deal. The flawed embouchure that I was talking about, which will be okay on French horn, by the way. If you can't get a kid to roll in and then, but they have good ears, okay, they're a French horn player. Because that roll is a big deal. When you roll in, the vibration's immediately higher. You know, it's, and by the way, lip buzzing and trumpet playing are really, really different. I'm not saying they're the same thing at all. But the principle there applies. When you roll the lip in so that it's rolled against the teeth, the teeth are here and it's rolling like so. You're using a firmer tissue and tissue that's more connected to the musculature. And so I compare it to a woodwind player using a thicker reed, you know, for a better sound. And that's where you'll get a thin kind of flabby sound from that unrolled so I have the students practice setting their upper lip, like rolling it in front of the teeth, and make them go ahead and roll it so you can see a little bit of the white of the teeth. They're not gonna play with it that much roll, but they need to explore that range of motion in the roll of the upper lip so that it's there, so that they activate those muscles, identify those muscles. If they go too far, that's fine. The tendency is so strong to unroll that it's not gonna be a problem. Like, you're not gonna have a kid who's too rolled, most likely. So they go ahead and tuck your upper lip, go ahead and use the fingers so you get an extreme kind of, and you dry out the teeth and your lip will stick. And that's silly, but the kids like it. And then when you put the lip together, okay, go ahead and adjust the teeth, dry off the upper tooth and do the wrap, and then close it. Okay, and what you've got there, if you look at your neighbors, is a very sort of rolled in, compact, embouchure. I do see some people with a little more spread than I'd like they smile in reaction to the roll. So if you can reconcile the roll with having the corners kind of forward too, the result of that might be that when you blow, you get a little puffing in the goatee area, and that's cool. Puffing out here is more likely a problem, but puffing under the goatee, I see world class players do it. It's not as big a deal as we might think. Okay, so you got the roll, and it'll take a lot longer for your students to get that concept, of course. Now, the other controversial thing I'm gonna do is the nose breath is something we generally, it's a big problem with young trumpet players who habitually take nose breaths, right? But I do need to start them with that nose breath so they can set up the embouchure, they get that rolled embouchure set up, and then, you know, when they take a mouth breath, they'll tend to release it, and they're not trained, they don't have the reaction yet to put it back together in time to make the sound. So that's the other reason they tend to end up with a very exposed embouchure. Because when they take the mouth breath, their chops are sort of soft and released. Now, so do this for me. Go ahead and get back in that position. Inhale through the nose. And then and don't vibrate, just make a, don't try to vibrate, just. Now, how many of you are getting an upstream where you're feeling under the tip of your nose? That's a good thing. That's how extreme I want to start. Your student may not play that upstream, and that's fine. It's probably not an extreme that most students will want to stay with, but we're counteracting the downstream gravity. So play with that a little until you get an upstream. And then experiment with how little muscle tone you need to maintain that, because you're going to tend to grip a little hard at the beginning. So you can say a student can comprehend that once they're in the position. Now you don't need to be as hard or firm here. You can see how much you can get away with. And you can blow pretty hard and it still won't unroll. So I'm seeing a lot of, like, it looks like the classic trumpet embouchure now. Now, as soon as you put the horn on it, it's going to go away if you don't do the next thing the way I'm going to play with it. And how should I do that? Okay, I don't want to skip the pop, though. So that's the next bullet point here. The pop is that moment when they release. We want an air seal to start with. Not a hard air seal, but we do want the lips together. We want to blow them apart. We don't want the lips to already have sort of, to not have good contact when we pin them down with the mouthpiece. You don't want that. We want them to, and we don't want the student pulling the lips open as like a substitute or part of their articulation. That's a mess. So you want the lips to be firmly pressed together, and the air pops a hole through them and determines how big the aperture is through the blow. So again, go ahead and do that. And you should hear that pop at the beginning. And instantaneous air probably on your nose. Unless you have a teeny tiny cute little nose. Okay, let's see. Let me watch if you can do that. You notice I haven't mentioned the lower lips roll, but I think everybody, as I look around, almost everybody's got a pretty good degree of roll, just as a four, one, two, three. So you have the students do quite a few of those pops, so they feel that instantaneous pop in the aperture. And I would do that timed so that they breathe on four, pop on one, in a moment that's deliberate, you know, that's expected. That'll help with some coordination of air and lift. Then once they have that, now we can go ahead and try inhaling through the mouth. You just went. Now give me. You need to get back to that same position and still try to get the same pop you had when you set up the embouchure in advance with a nose breath. Okay, cool. So alternate the two so the student gets the feeling of having a good contact, a good relaxed contact between roll lips. And then, and again, no vibration is necessary at this point. Sometimes they'll get a vibration, but usually not with the lip rolled in. This is sort of the seductive aspect of lip rolled out. They get a vibration immediately, but it'll lock them out of the high register, I promise you. Or at least they'll have to work really hard. So they're alternating the mouth and nose breath, and then when we put the horn on, we go back to the nose breath. Maybe I should just volunteer. Can I see everybody's? Please, let me see that again. Okay. Oh, that looks good. Yeah. Let's see. I'm trying to feel. I'm looking at who I feel lucky with. Can I use you? Come on.
Woo!
And I think. No, we'll do it. We'll have a stand if you don't mind. Go ahead and bring the horn. You're ready to make your first sound. Are you a brass player?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. No, I don't want to use you yet. You're already too educated.
Daddy, right next to you.
Yes. Who's not a brass player?
Daddy.
Oh.
So you're not a brass player?
Okay. I'm a percussionist.
Oh, that's perfect. Yeah. Okay, now we need to turn you this way. Actually, let's have a stand. I think the visual is better. Now, take the instrument away from the child. Okay, can I see that setup you just did? Can't we keep going through the whole thing? Because the kid's gonna relapse, for sure. Yeah, your jaw is still, air on the side of the jaw being even too far forward, even farther forward. There's still overlap with the top teeth and the bottom. There we go. Yeah, that looks good. Okay, now I know the teeth are pretty closed now. I'm not worried about that long term. If they will come open, and if we have to, we'll talk about it. But this starts things slow. Okay, go ahead and think that. The roll that, yeah, that's a good roll. Okay. Inhale through the nose and pop the air through. Yeah, nice. And just try to keep that airstream up. And you may have to have a feeling that the lower lip is a little in front of the upper lip rather than this. We're gonna go to an exaggeration because when I put the horn on. Anyway. Okay, good. Okay, now relax and release your face. Yeah. Because you'll have to do that. Is anybody sore already from holding that? Yeah, you have to, that's a mistake in what I've done so far, is that I haven't had you release it enough. I've let you have the thing engaged for 20 seconds at a time. Not awesome. Don't do that. Remind them to release it. Okay. Right on. Okay, now, you're going to close your eyes, and I'm just going to place it where I think it goes, and we'll see what comes out. If you get a sound, you sustain it, as long as it'll sustain, which may be 2 seconds or maybe 10. Okay. Nice big relaxed inhale. And you're gonna pop the air through and I'll place it on that. Well, I'll give it a little more pop, so relax and then. Good. This will take a few attempts, I'm sure. That's no problem. Maybe not in the middle. We get a little hiss at the front. soul out of your body fast is way better than over engaging the air. So, okay, here we go. I mean, they gotta have their eyes closed when you put it on, otherwise. Good. All right, you hear the squealies? That's
yeah.
A good sign. When you hear the squeals up there, little wheep, wheep, little hamster farts, those are good. Help out the sound. Better problem to have.
Okay.
I'm putting it on different every time. I'm not that accurate. Yeah, so he's, and he, you know, the kid will manipulate a little bit as he's finding. I'm screwing around with the angle a little, like not in an extreme way, but I'm just kind of rocking the motor on the face, and when it ignites, I stop, of course. I'm going for something that looks centered, looks about 50-50, but the human error factor is pretty good here because you'll end up accidentally exploring some of the reasonable options, the reasonable range of where the thing will go. I'm not too concerned if you end up with a student a few degrees too far this way, a few degrees too far that way, it's fine. The big problem is the unroll, the downstream, and if they end up set on the lower lip, like the, I'll demonstrate that crappy embouchure, and then I'll demonstrate the other crappy embouchure. Okay. Sometimes you may have to alternate you putting it on, them putting it on, but they got to keep the routine of the the bell up. So yeah, let's do that one more time. Don't move the home. So properly.
Good.
Somebody to see them and say, that looks right, or that slip. You don't have to be a trumpet player to see this much. You know, it's fairly clear. Good, thanks. So that's how I get the initial sound. Did I miss anything here? And 50-50? Yeah, and you notice I've got these sort of, you notice I can say, like, in 1 in 3 attempts, sound starts, and the student has a sense of where it goes, then the student can take over. I want to get, and we were getting, like, at least 1 in 3 attempts, we were getting an ignition of sound. Good. You know, I'm probably overstating the don't accept that at the second to last bullet point, because I do accept a certain amount of compromise. That's fine. But you'll see the difference when it's a totally different embouchure that they put together, when all of a sudden they go back to... You'll see that return, and you go, oh, you know, and you try to get it reset. But that level of just sort of lip relaxing forward a little bit, that's cool. Yes, the catastrophic flaws in an embouchure, that unrolled upper lip. This I want to make a big point of, because it's, I think, the hardest thing I have to fix in students, and it happens a lot. So your lower lip has a ridge to it between the red and the white. If a kid sets above that ridge, so that there's a little bit of red showing, just a sliver of red showing under the mouthpiece, then every time they add any pressure, they push the aperture open, and it causes a bunch of other things to, like a cascade of horror ensues. And it's a pretty frequent thing. I'll do it. Where I set on the lower lip. You want their entire lower lip, you want that ridge of the lower lip to be inside the rim, for sure. And the same thing can happen with the upper lip. If the lip is really, if they have a really full lip, I actually probably can't reproduce this one because my lip's not full enough, but if you have a kid with really full lips, they can set in the middle of the, like they'll set with the ridge of the upper lip above the mouthpiece. And it may be, so they may have a really low set. And they may get a lot, they may get kind of a, they may have halfway decent high register that way, but the sound will be really the sound will have that rigid, brittle quality, and it's really hard to fix. So, you hear those whistles that you just got? She was blowing, and she's getting, like, you'll hear whistles that precede the sound happening. And you can tell the student, yeah, those whistles are a good sign, that's almost a sound. Because it's encouraging. The kid's going to freak out a little bit when they start blowing, and the nightmare thing they don't want to have to happen is, I can't make a sound. You know, that's what their inner dialogue probably will be, inner monologue will be, if they're, when they first put it on, if no sound comes. Yeah, so you hear that.
I can't control this part, whatever that pop is rolling
in. It looks perfect. So you may feel like it's, oh, you mean you can't manipulate it?
Yes.
That's a pretty good thing, because it's not going to move much in playing from... It's not gonna. It's pretty stiff. The lip is very. It's all really small motor inside the mouthpiece kind of manipulation. So yeah, you're not gonna feel. That's also to a kid that probably feels constrained. They'll feel crowded inside the mouthpiece relative to the embouchure. You know. Up for 2 or 3 days after putting my face together wrong like that. Okay, so once the kid is, that's enough of that. I've already said most of it. So now, more vowel positions. So when the kid's making, igniting the sound pretty consistently on the open vowel position, you let them try various vowel positions. You don't have to tell them what the notes are yet. If they have a digital tuner on a smartphone, that'll tell them what the note names are. allowed to really pay attention to the needle yet. That's later, right? You want them to just see what comes out on each of the fingering combinations. So they do long tones. You tell them that the whole, right now, quantity is quality. You just want to make long sounds. Longer sounds are, if you can sustain any pitch 8 to 10 seconds, then, okay, you've found a good position to play it from, and that's going to be a solid part of your register. So especially the bottom vowel combinations, the longer versions of the trumpet, you know, 1 and 3 and 1, 2, and 3 are using much more pipe and have more resistance. And if they're doing this thing, they'll have more targets to choose from in the lower fingerings. They have more options. So you can emphasize those, even though they're not going to play those pitches with those fingerings. They're not going to play a G, this G. They're not going to play that one for usually. But we're going to use that fingering for igniting the sound at the beginning, and then for lip slurs. The lower fingerings are really important. They have more range in the lower fingerings. They might be able to play 5 or 6 notes across the series on 1, 2, and 3. We do a lot of our slurs on open, and then they only have, usually all they've got is is 4 notes. And it's, and then they have to, and the notes are farther apart in the open position, so they have to be more, they have to effort more. The lower positions, 1, 2, and 3, and 1 and 3, doing slurs on those, they'll tend to have to deliver more air. It's because it's just more horn to vibrate. That's going to have really healthy impacts on the higher fingerings, 1, 2, 1, 2, open, the friendlier fingerings that we use all the time. So the 1, 3 and 1, 2, and 3 fingerings are neglected. It's a problem. And I understand why it's a problem in the methods, because if you've got a classroom of kids, everything we're doing here assumes that you can get a kid alone for a minute, or that you have a small group of kids, and you can have them watch you work with somebody individually. And if you don't have that situation, it's really difficult, because they're each going to get a different pitch. The only pitch they can all get consistently as a group is a low C on a crappy embouchure. If you give them an embouchure that's married to the bottom register, you'll have a whole room full of fat low Cs, and you'll feel like a genius. But with that embouchure, they are locked out of the high register. All right, I haven't talked about, they need to go back and forth between sliding the horn on with you can dispense with the nose breath when they're consistently getting a sound. Then they'll do the mouth breath, but they'll still slide it on. And then you transition to something more like what we expect to see, mouth breath and immediate setup. What you want them to do for the rest of their trumpet playing life. Give them plenty of time to take a breath. And at that point, they'll be doing, igniting the sound with the routine they're going to use pretty much from then on. Now, introducing the tongue. How am I doing for time? 9:30. Good. Introducing the tongue. You probably all have the experience of the kids. Their first experience with the tongue will often be kind of detached, like where they're restarting the airstream each time. If they habituate that first, it's a long road to a good legato. And they won't be sustaining very much in their day-to-day practice. Not as much as if you start with the legato tongue. I teach a legato tongue on single notes first. And you do that off the horn. You have them, whatever syllable you like. Coo is a nice compromise. A lot of professional trumpet players actually do say T for everything that's not the bottom register. We're just a smaller instrument. The whole Paul Po thing is coming from Chicago School low brass pedagogy. And but two is a nice sort of compromise syllable for everybody. So if they're saying, let me hear that sound from you guys. And then we're just going to put the bumps in it. We're going to go, but it's one release all the way through, of course. after three tongues, maybe, right? You're already a little lightheaded, maybe, if you're in the cardiovascular shape I'm in. Then, when you close the lip with the embouchure we just learned, they'll have enough resistance to take you many, many more. But that's the point at which they'll tend to start stopping and starting or putting ebb and flow in the airstream. They'll start doing that huffing thing. So you want to get a bunch of legato tongues. The tongue just darting in and out of the airstream. If the tongue is sluggish, slow to get in or out, if the upstroke or the downstroke is sluggish, then there's time for them to disrupt the airstream, to stop the airstream. So you want to emphasize just that it's a single airstream. As far as your ear knows, you're just playing a long tone, and then your tongue gets involved by just making these in like razor thin, quick strikes, like snake-like, whip-like strikes. So even when you're playing a very legato sound, the tongue is pretty energized. Ideally, the end of the note sounds as good as the beginning. I mean, directing a kid's ears to the end of the sound, it's hard, right? Like, our attention goes to the beginning of the sound always. So you can have them practice this on this embouchure on various rhythms. If you want them to, if you do call and response with various rhythms on that, as long as they keep the airstream constant, as long as the airstream is still just long tone airstream, probably just doing even articulations is going to get boring for them in a hurry. A lot of repetition of that articulation. Okay. And then they'll alternate that on and off the trumpet. It's important for me to mention the pop again here too, that every time they tongue, there's a moment when the lips snap together and pop again, in the same way that the initiation of the sound was. And it's actually that pop that is really the articulation. That's really what makes the pop in the lip is what makes the articulation. The tongue just permits or generates that pop in the lip. A kid can tongue pretty hard, but if the lip doesn't, if they don't have an air seal that's gonna pop, have it like a split second pop, closed and open, if they don't have that air seal, then they won't get much clarity in their articulation. They'll get a lot of clarity if that lip is, again, with the embouchure that I've shown you, if the lip has air seal before they tongue. I want to not compromise the end of each note, and I want every front to be firm and pretty consistent. And if you get that legato tongue going on long tones again, which is also making them sustain sound, so that's like helping in from various arenas, then you've got really good odds of having a clear articulation and a pretty nimble tongue, a tongue that's not, well, and even more important, they're not going to be puffing, changing the airstream with every articulation, which you know is
you're supposed to slow the airflow down, because when I'm tongueing like that, I'm using my tongue, but my lip won't close.
Oh, it doesn't matter if your lip, you don't need to buzz the lip, but the lip, can I see what you mean? Go ahead. Yeah, you're maintaining.
I don't feel my lips actually touching.
Oh, you're blowing the lip open. You're blowing an aperture open. There's the moment before the pop when the lips momentarily seal. And then you're blowing and keeping the hole open with that steady airstream. And what you're doing is absolutely right. I see the sort of some inflation that tells me that you're not deflating at all between notes. The airstream is unrelentless.
Okay. I thought you were saying a few minutes ago that your lips should cut back.
They do, but you don't really feel that. You just hear the pop.
Okay.
The pop is produced by the lips, really like microseconds of lip contact. In the moment in that split second when the tongue strikes, the lips do sort of clap back together and then immediately pop back open and just bounce off of each other. do it off, on and off the instrument, and even when they've been playing for a while, you can have them do that with various rhythms that you're trying to get together. If you hear a whole group do a rhythm together, it'll sound pretty clean if they're doing it right. Like if I have you all go two in time, 1, 2, 3. Yeah, let's do it again. 2, 3. You try to get that moment of the pop to be precise. And that sort of attunes the kid's ear to the fact that that's a real split second thing. And then we put that on the horn, and it's a lot of what the kids don't realize is long tone sustaining is you're getting the articulation practice and the long tone sustaining. Then we deal with detached tonguing. But you gotta have a legato tonguing first. they get this feeling of relentless, always engaged air, long tone air. Let's see. Then the other thing you can do, these are also like long tones in disguise, which are, there's trills that don't require a change in the air of the lip, like F to G. That'll just come out as fast as their little fingers will go, because they don't have, it's the same blow for both of those notes. The chops don't have to do anything. There's other notes that have a bump between them, like C to D is a big problem because it's required a lot in our music. Is like that was years of work right there. I have to make a difference in the blow between each note, or I have to stay high on the. Anyway, they won't be able to do that trill. Most of your high school students can't trill between C and D fast, and you would think they could, but there's a bump there. The notes between which there is no bump, they can instantly just blow long tone air. So F to G is one of those, and you have them do crescendos and decrescendos because that's kind of like, it makes it feel more musical to them. You know, you have them play with that and you give them, yeah, anyway, that's dynamic practice as well, of course. I list some of them here. What did I say? E to F, if they don't have the F to G. Those you don't need, they're all just long tone. So, and that gets the fingers moving fast. They get the feeling of throwing the fingers, as I said before. D to E, this one is one they have to use a lot, and that's a nightmare. They don't have to pull the slide in for the E, because E is unaffected by the first slide, right? There's only air going through these two pipes. But that. Just do that once on your horn. Just alternate between E and D. And you want it to clack. Yeah, and that's. Probably for some of you woodwind players, that seems like a very minor problem. But the valve stroke is longer for us, and kids will try to, like, they'll be averse to that particular one, among many others. This one they don't like either. 1 and 3 to 2. What else, though? There's a few that are particularly awkward. This one. 1, 2, and 3 to 2. Those are awkward fingerings. So you can have them practice those as finger warm-ups. I don't know if I listed that one. But the D and E is really pretty useful thing to do. If you have them get that really, if you have a group of people do it in time, it'll sound, you know, it'll be steady, sort of steady 8 notes. Let's do that once. If we go 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and, and loud enough that I can hear the valve clap. 3 and 4 and clap, 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 clap. That's kind of awkward, isn't it? Yeah, you don't do that with the flute. It's much more like finger, and also much much shorter valve strokes. So, like the rotary valve trumpet is actually, some things are easier on it because of that. Okay, the other thing I do with the beginnings of scale patterns is I teach them the first 5 notes of major scales before I teach them the entire 8 notes, because often they don't have a full octave they can control. They maybe can play long tones across that full octave, probably, but So those, the keys I listed there are the ones that are frequently used, and they have, and a five note pattern is narrow enough, most of them could play that smoothly, or if there's a problem, they'll be able to sort out, oh, okay, it's when I go to this top C that I start to, that it doesn't sound good. If that's flat or something, they'll hear those problems in the context of a five note pattern. Later on, that makes it easier to talk about what the root, third, and fifth are. There's a bunch of reasons I do that. If they know all their five note patterns, then they can build major scales that way. I'll give you the whole shtick. Two five note patterns, one on top of the other, like let's say C, D, E, F, G, G, A, B, C, D, those two five note patterns fit together and you have a full scale up to the ninth, right? So that's helpful if you're talking about the D flat scale. Five note pattern, D flat, five note pattern on A flat. D flat, E flat, F, G flat, A flat, A flat, B flat, C, D flat, E flat. I got the itsy bitsy spider thing going there. You guys do that down south? Never mind. So that's major on top of major. But if you go major on the bottom, minor on top, because it's pretty easy. If they've got the five note pattern, C, D, E, F, G, it's easier for them to move to C, D, E flat, F, G. Okay, if you got the major on the bottom, the minor on top, you have the Mixolydian scale, so that covers their dominant chords in jazz band, which is important. And then, if you have minor on top of minor, you have the Dorian minor scale, so which is what they use in jazz as well, right? So, and then it's a fairly easy transition to flat this note, and they've got the natural minor. So I do that progressively, teaching scales as combinations of two five note patterns. And the result of that too is when they get up into the higher, they make transitions through registers more smoothly if they isolate those manageable registers. Even better is the chromatic scale. The first study in the Clark book, this pattern in 3-4. That's like given in the Clark book in all keys, and they can work gradually up and down. But you got to have a pretty industrious student to make that go. I do like to get them at least a couple chromatic scales going fairly early on. That would be another thing I would do toward the beginning. I would go from G down to D flat, so they feel that sequence of all seven vowel positions. That's what those positions are numbered, then you can talk to your trombonists and trumpet players in the same language. Go to third position. Does anybody do that down here? That was like a Texas thing that I saw. Okay. So yeah, G down to D flat as a chromatic pattern. It doesn't require much of them chop wise. It really feels a lot like a long tone, like another long tone. They're sustaining. So there's a lot of sustaining in this, in my way of approaching it. The first slurs we do, I already mentioned that if they're slurring, as it will be in the book, they're often slurring on an open finger. But there's not enough options. I do start with 1 and 3. Once they open the G, I replace it with an alternate fingering, make a big deal out of it. This is only for lip slurs, it's an alternate fingering. Which starts with two note slurs like that, all the two note slurs. And then the next shut up. You know, all the pairs that they can reach at any given time. Then I go to the three note slurs, and then the four note slurs. So. Three note slurs, and then four note slurs. those slurs as we can. And I've got it all on one, like, 4 or 5 page lip slur compendium. Each one of those is just a bar with a repeat sign on either end of it. I'll send it out to you. And because I want them to do a lot of repetitions of any given slur, just not as fast as I just did it. Now I'm hurrying because, yeah. But a bunch of smooth repetitions. Maybe even slower than that. But in try to get them in rhythm, at least after they've explored the slur a little. They can explore the slur kind of out of rhythm, but then they need to try to know the exact instant they're trying to change the sound, because they're trying to change the note. They're coordinating air and lip in the same microsecond. They need to decide which microsecond, which it's best if actually the metronome decides, right? When they get into, like, if they're having, let's say they're getting stuck here. You get that stick between lip slurs. That's when I find the first really great application of buzzing, which is to make a slow glissando from between those two targets. If they can do it against a drone on a keyboard, so they have both pitch references there. I'll put it on organ mode and then sit an unused mouthpiece on the key, and that'll hold the key down with the weight, and then you get organ. And you can that way you can quickly just use them as paperweights on the keyboard. So you have those two pitches ringing, maybe. Wait, no, these two, that's what I meant. And then you make the glissando as slow and gooey as they can. With a lot of crescendo, no if. They'll end up using a lot more air than they're accustomed to. If they make that glissando so that it sustains all the way with no sort of moment when the lip ratchets the pitch into the spot, they don't, like, the lip grips suddenly and then that moment of the lip becoming active and just placing the note. We don't want to use that unless we absolutely have to. We save that for the upper register and for certain things. Departure from every note, smooth arrival on every note, not notching it in. If a kid can do that, or at least aspire to that, try to get smooth glissandi, they're training some really fine muscle work. That's the book that my teacher at Eastman wrote. Has like a play along just with these chord progressions and buzzing exercises across that. That's the most thorough trumpet pedagogy I've ever seen. But the kid's got to be a real, like, a real industrious, serious-minded, mature kid to use that program. So I'm always kind of adapting it for younger students. The buzzing thing we were talking about, the problem with starting the buzzing is they tend not to fuel it well, and they tend to start kind of low, and they'll get a buzz. When you start a student, if you start them with the buzz, they'll achieve the buzz, again, with the rolled out lip and the downstream. When they're using just the mouthpiece, they're all very aware of the angle as well. So I wait till a little later to get into that. And I use it at the point at which I'm concerned about them getting stuck in slurs and fueling various registers appropriately. That's when the buzz is really helpful. Indefinite pitch exercise. That would be this. We're always deciding what pitch we're going to play before. That's generally what musicians do, right? But it's useful on the mouthpiece to just decide on a certain blow and then see what comes out. To go, okay, like I'm going to take a little faster inhale and a more energetic exhale than sort of my baseline. And if I put that through the mouthpiece, I'll probably get something higher than my baseline. And I didn't choose a pitch, I just threw air. A lot likewise, to go the other extreme, a slow inhale, an immediate slow, very mellow return. And you see what pitch comes out, if any. I'm not controlling what pitch comes out, I just see what comes out, and that's good information for a kid. So if they're buzzing in the car or something, or they're buzzing without the horn available to them, it's a good exercise. I don't know if you can explain that to them without demonstrating. Just play with how quickly you inhale, or and see what comes out. Because often they'll discover that with a certain breath, the high register ignites rather easily, and then they go, "Oh, that's so that's it. It's not gripping with the face. It's not a teeny tiny mouthpiece like the lead piece things. The jet pump, whatever it is people are using now. It's that it has to do with the return of the air. I think that's the end of my. Yeah, that's the end of the handout. Now we technically have 6 more minutes, but I should ask. Does anybody have any questions? How's is that all? What are you thinking? It's a long session.